living in crazy times is an understatement. Have you been paying attention at all to what's happening on the American landscape without even panning out to look at the landscape of the world in general? You all know what happened on March 10th. The 16th largest bank in the United States, Silicon Valley Bank, crashed. Why did it crash? Now, I'm not going to spend our time this morning getting into the details of what factors contribute to the failing of an economic system or a financial institution, but from the standpoint of people who believe the gospel, it's vitally important that we understand that every single thing happening in this world, listen carefully now, is governed by principles. We live in a world of laws, not just laws of physics. What goes up must come down. We understand the law of gravity. We understand the law of aerodynamics that is harnessed to allow planes to fly through the sky and not crash. We understand the laws of physics at a basic level, but I'm suggesting to you that every single thing going on in the world is governed by laws, by principles. There are not only physical laws, there are social laws. For example, you have probably heard the really nicely phrased little proverb, respect begets respect. It's a social law. If I relate to you with a respectful attitude and demeanor, it's highly likely that you're going to reciprocate. You're going to relate to me with respect. I did my own social experiment one time in New York City. It's a fun thing to walk through New York City and try to get eye contact with the tens of thousands of people that are all going somewhere on those streets. They're passing you by, they're bumping you as they go, and all of them are looking down. All of them are looking down. You're passing all these human beings. Any one of them could be your best friend from high school, but he wouldn't know it because he's looking down. So I did an experiment. I walked for 44 blocks on New York streets and tried to get eye contact with people. You know what I had to do to get eye contact with people because they were all looking down? I had to start going like this and doing a sidewinder kind of move and looking up into their eyes and flashing a smile. And some people were so angry at the smile that they imploded right before me. But there were others who just couldn't resist, and they smiled back ever so slightly and lifted their eyes for a moment, and there was this beautiful little human contact that occurred. I was like, hi, I exist, and so do you. And we like each other. Don't we? No, we don't. On they go. There are laws that govern not only the physical universe, but there are social laws. Respect begets respect. There's also economic laws. Money is a commodity that we trade back and forth that has monetary value. I give you $20, you give me hopefully 20 avocados. If you go to Costco, that'll only be 10 avocados for $20 because there's something called inflation or something else called interest. And these numbers move around. And as these numbers move around, something else is moving around. And it's very psychological. As the numbers regarding our money move around, something moves inside of us. The thing that moves inside of us is the psychological phenomenon of trust. If I were to pull out a $20 bill this morning and show it to you, you would automatically know that that has $20 of value. Actually, it has no intrinsic value. It's a piece of paper. The value of the $20 note is your perception of its value, squared by my perception of its value. And because I believe that it's worth $20, and you believe that it's worth $20 of purchasing power, that agreement between us is an imaginary monetary value. So I give you the $20, you give me 20 avocados. We and both of us are satisfied. I got the better deal in most cases because I have something usable. I have avocados from which you can make guacamole, which is so good. And you have a piece of paper that has no intrinsic value at all unless, are you tracking? The next person you go to with that $20 also agrees that it has value. But what if you get stuck with a $20 bill at a moment in time when a sizable part of the population decides that it's only worth $10 of avocado value? Or, worse yet, what if you come into the possession of my $20 bill when a sizable percentage of the population decides that it's not worth anything? You're stuck with a piece of paper that has no intrinsic value, and you can't do anything with it. So what has happened? Well, a sociological phenomenon has intersected with an economic phenomenon, which has intersected with a psychological phenomenon, and it looks something like this. Mismanagement generates mistrust in the person or the system holding the money, or in this case, a number that says that we have $16 billion of value in this bank. So mismanagement of the financial institution yields mistrust. The moment there's mistrust, some significant percentage of the people who have money in that financial institution will engage in a swarming effect. They will make what's called a bank run. What does that mean? That means that they line up at the bank and they want to get their money which way? Out of that system and put it somewhere else, maybe under their bed. Oh, they make a bank run. The bank has to inform them, hey, wait a minute, you're here to get your money, and we don't happen to have your money anymore. Which reinforces what their hunch was. I can't trust you because you mismanaged my money. So now that they're refusing you, you are in full-on panic trying to get your money out, and on March 10, just 8 days ago, the bank in California, based in California, the Silicon Valley Bank, collapsed right before our eyes, the 16th largest bank in the world, the single most disastrous financial collapse in any of our lifetimes, except for 2007-2008. Well, 2007-2008 was much more widespread. And what happened there was the same basic pattern. Dastardly dudes doing dastardly deeds with people's money, leading to an eventual sense of mistrust, leading to an eventual kind of larger scale bank run, leading to a near collapse of the entire world economy. And the assessment is that maybe it was 30 guys who did it, almost all of which walked away with multi-million dollar packages of financial bonuses in order to walk away from the system and turn it over to the government for bailout. Now, when a bailout occurs, you have to remember that what's happening there is the government, per se, is not bailing out these financial institutions. The people are with their tax dollars. So, on March 10, we witnessed another one of these events. And essentially, what I'm trying to say to you this morning is that the core of it all is broken trust. The only way the economic system works is if we all collectively agree that $20 is worth 20 avocados. And the moment inflation or taxation or interest alters the numbers, so that you can't get the same amount of value, i.e. products and services, for your $20 bill, you begin to mistrust the system and you try to back out of the system to do something else with your money. Now, this phenomenon of mistrust is not just economic in nature, it's also political in nature. The Pew Research in 2022, just 1 year ago, did their updated survey in the American population for those who were willing to engage in the survey, a sample size that was large enough to give us a pretty solid sense of where trust is regarding American government and politicians in particular. Only 2% of Americans, according to Pew Research, trust the government to do the right thing just about always. And only 19% of Americans trust the government to do the right thing most of the time. Essentially, what these numbers indicate is that we, generally speaking, do not trust our government. We don't believe in the system. We are generally under the impression that those who are leading us are not worthy of leading us because they can't be trusted to do the right thing. And yet, it's a very strange predicament to be in, because they can't is in quote marks here, because there's a little bit of wiggle room, but essentially they can't be removed. And why can't they be removed from these high offices in the land? Why is it that whether you look to the right or to the left on the political spectrum, you see lying, cheating, corruption? Essentially, American politics, by general recognition, now, there may be, well, about 2% of people, according to Pew Research, who actually believe the government is trustworthy to some significant degree. But by and large, we don't believe that. By and large, most of us, if we stop and think about it, are under the general kind of impression, whether we've done a lot of reading and looked at the facts or not, we have a general sense that American politics is now a legalized system of bribery. And we know that we can't get these people out of office, and so the number of Americans who actually vote is dropping off precipitously. In a group this size, there are at least 50% of you who just don't vote at all. You're just so exhausted by the system, and you so mistrust it that you are under the kind of subconscious impression that really it means nothing if I vote. And in a broad general sense, you would be right. You would be right because you've noticed in your lifetime, if you're over 20 years of age, that no matter which party is in power, the national deficit always goes up. Military spending always goes up. We're always engaged in some foreign war. Always. It doesn't matter which party is in power. The net effect is always the same. And so many people have just given up on the system altogether and won't even vote because they're under the impression that democracy itself is under threat and that voting doesn't do a whole lot. Well, broken trust is very hard to repair. We know this on an interpersonal level, right? If you just have a relationship with an individual person and trust is broken, it may take, depending on the nature of the break, depending on how egregious it is, it may take years even for you to ever believe that person has good intentions again once trust is broken. That's the predicament that we find ourselves in on a general national level as Americans. Now, the reason I bring this to your attention is not to rail on the American government, but to give us, by contrast, a perspective on the way the Bible describes an economic system that operates at the optimal level. Now, there's a lot that the Bible has to say about economics, about finances, about money. In fact, some scholars have suggested that topic-wise, the single most addressed topic in Scripture is money. Now, this is one of the things that the Bible says about money, going all the way back thousands of years to Moses. This is thousands of years ago. You would think that this kind of perspective could not exist in an ancient barbaric world. This is far too sophisticated. This is beyond Harvard University. This is beyond Cambridge. This is an economic system that is so simple and profound that it takes a breath away. Moses said to the children of Israel after having delivered them from Egyptian bondage, he said, "Gather around, children of Israel, we're going to talk about money." He had a lot to say about money. And one of the things he had to say about money was, do not cheat anyone by using false measures of length, weight, or quantity. Use honest scales, honest weights, and honest measures. I am the Lord, your God, and I brought you out of Egypt. Now, the word Lord there is in small caps because the translators of the English version of the Bible want us to know that that is Yahweh. Anytime you read in your English Bible, the word Lord in the Old Testament capitalized, the word in the Hebrew language is Yahweh. Yahweh is distinguishing himself. Watch this, you guys. Distinguishing himself from whatever the children of Israel were experiencing where? In Egypt. I want you to deal with your money, your economics, like this, because I'm Yahweh. I'm not, by contrast, like what you were experiencing in Egypt. So in this simple statement, you have a very profound economic law. Let's move through it point by point. The key points in the text are these. First of all, the text addresses the idea of cheating financially. It says, don't do that. Do not engage in financial shenanigans. Do not financially cheat any fellow human being. No cheating allowed. That's a very simple thing to say, and yet it's almost non-existent in the world economic system. In fact, the world economic system, as we know it right now, is in fact, without exaggeration, a system that is actually engineered to make the maximum amount of cheating possible. It is literally a cheating system, and those of us who are in the middle class and the poorer classes know that it is a cheating system, at least on an intuition level. So no cheating. It seems like a very simple thing to say. It's a very profound thing to say. And to not cheat means that you cannot use false measures. You can't, in other words, you know, a way of saying this in mathematical terms, rather than, you know, I've got some rice or beans here on the scale that I want to weigh against the, the basil and the pasta that you want to trade for. This is the context here. If you were to put this in financial terms, it would be something like, don't fudge the numbers. Don't mess with the math. Let the numbers say what they say, and don't lie in your accounting practices. That's what that means. You would engage in honest measurements, or that is, you would engage in honestly crunching the numbers so as to communicate effectively what the financial situation in the giving predicament happens to be. And then there is not only a contrast between false measuring and honest measuring, that is a contrast between Egypt and Yahweh. Yahweh is a particular kind of God who is the kind of God who wants honest dealings between fellow human beings on an economic level. So this is one snapshot, little photo of the character of God that is absolutely beautiful. We say God is good, but we mean this in a very concrete sense. God is good in many different ways, and here's one of the ways in which God is good. God is diametrically opposed to financial mismanagement. Is that a good thing in your perspective or a bad thing? It's a good thing. God is in favor of honesty and integrity in financial dealings. That's who Yahweh is. And then he says, I am Yahweh who brought you out of that other place where money is not handled correctly, where there is a mismanagement of resources that led you to be slaves, in fact. And now, through my servant Moses, you have been led out of Egyptian bondage, and the first thing on the agenda is, don't be like what I delivered you out of. Don't operate in relation to one another economically the way you were related to economically in Egypt. We're going to raise the standard, and the standard now is honest financial dealings. This is what might be called, and I've called a few times when we spent time together, so for some of you who have been here quite a bit, you'll be familiar with this term. This is what we might call covenant economics. This is a unique economic system that was articulated by Moses that is not communism and is not capitalism. It's something else entirely that takes the best principles of all economic systems, and somehow Moses understood how to pull those things together in one system. It's called covenant economics. What is covenant economics? Well, here's one way of summarizing the teachings of the Bible and the teachings of Moses in particular with regards to money, with regards to finances. This is what Stephen Covey in the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People termed the win-win principle. The word principle here means law, like the law of gravity, right? So the win-win, what is the win-win principle? The win-win principle simply says that in any financial transaction that occurs, there should be two winners, not a winner and a loser. So if I have a Toyota Camry, for example, and that Toyota Camry, I want to sell it now, and I happen to know that it has a bad transmission, but this isn't really showing up consistently yet. So I'm hoping to sell you the Toyota Camry without you knowing that it has a bad transmission. So it's your problem, not mine. And secondly, so I can charge an amount for the Toyota Camry that would assume a good transmission. So what does Kelley Blue Book say? A Toyota Camry is worth of that year, of that condition, assuming that there are no mechanical problems. Well, it's worth, let's say, $5,000 with a good transmission. It's an old Toyota Camry. You should give it to your grandson. Don't even try to sell it. $5,000. But you get the point. The point is, it's worth $5,000 if it has a good transmission. But if the transmission, to replace the transmission, would cost, I don't know how much transmission costs. Let's say a transmission costs $1,000. You should sell the car for how much? $4,000. You should have a conversation with the potential buyer. Hey, just so you know, this is a very good car, but it has bad transmissions. It's going to cost you about $1,000 to replace the transmission. I'm just disclosing that ahead of time so that you can. And it's worth $5,000 for a good transmission, but really it's only worth $4,000. And I'm just going to take another, like, I don't know, $200 off for the trouble that you're going to have to go through to, so you can have this Camry for, and then you've lowered the price to $3,800. And then you have win-win. Each person in the deal feels like, wow, I scored. This is great. I got how much money it's actually worth. I got the Toyota Camry that I want. All I need to do is replace the transmission, and the thing will go another 100,000 miles because it's not a Ford. That was funny. Okay, so the win-win principle just says that in every economic exchange, you're never, ever, ever trying to take advantage of somebody. That's all the principle says, right? Now, this is where, as I mentioned a moment ago, we're all beginning to sense, even if we can't wrap words around it, that wait a minute, I mean, I don't know if any of you watched the recent Twitter file congressional hearings, but it's very hard to process that it's like we picked the most inept human beings in our population to run the country. That's what it looks like if you just watch these congressional hearings. So what's going on here is the government, essentially right now, takes public money and funnels it to private corporations, and the private corporations can pump some of the money back to the politicians that serve them on the legislative level by creating the laws and reinforcing laws and systems that allow for money to be mismanaged with impunity, so that you can literally take the 16th largest bank in the world down in utter collapse, and nobody is accountable for it. And on March 11th or 12th, after the collapse on the 10th, the federal government took over that bank, and in order to ensure that all of the money that was in the bank is accounted for and all of the people with money in the system would be made whole. Now we have to watch the government run that bank. And increasingly what's happening in the United States is small local banks are being put out of the market because they're not insured by the federal government, and larger banks and financial institutions are taking more and more and more and more and more and more of the financial capital that is available for investment, and we are increasingly witnessing the United States government being in charge of almost everything that touches our private lives. We thought it was just the public school system. We thought it was just the public media. Well, now, increasingly, the banking system is coming increasingly under the control of the American political system, the very people that not even 5% of us believe are trustworthy to hold their offices, but they're in charge of the money, increasingly, more and more and more. So 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 10 is what's called an end-time prophecy. This is where Paul, looking down the corridors of time by the aid of the Holy Spirit, says, I'll tell you what it's going to be like at the end of the world. The love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. That's 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. He's setting us up for something. And then he says, in his second letter to Timothy, chapter 3, after making the statement about the nature of money being the root of, by the way, I should point this out. Do you see how kinds of evil is italicized? The reason the translators do that is because they want to, you know, be transparent and tell you that they added those words. Those words don't have an exact parallel in the Greek language for the New Testament. So they italicize it. So actually what it says in the Greek is the love of money is the root of just all evil. Go ahead and process that. So the love of money is the root of all evil. What does he mean as the root of all evil? The root of all evil, the root of all kinds of evil. He's essentially saying that if you want to figure out any situation, what do we say? What do we say sometimes? Just follow the money. Just follow the money. If you just follow money, wherever you find large sums of money being pooled, you'll find the most dastardly dudes on planet Earth. Because what's happening is, the more money a person has, the more at liberty they feel to do horrible things because they know that they can't be held accountable by the system because the system exists to serve their financial interests. So what's happening is he's preparing us for something. Paul's preparing us for something. He writes to Timothy, he says, okay, money's problematic. Just want you to know that, Timothy. Money is problematic. It is the root of all kinds of evil. Now watch this. Then his second letter says, hey, by the way, that money subject we were talking about in that first letter I wrote to you, he's got a second letter to Timothy. Hey, Timothy, in the last days, perilous times will come. The word perilous could be translated dangerous times. In the last days, when human history begins to wind down, there's going to be some dangerous stuff going down. Perilous times will come. Paul, what will define those perilous times? What will make those times so perilous? Why will those times be dangerous? Paul, how would you define the danger factor in the last days? Well, I'll tell you, because men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. And the grammar here is very clear. the perilous times that will characterize the last days will be perilous precisely because of selfishness and greed. That's what the text says. Grammatically, Paul is prophesying that the end of human history will be super dangerous and disastrous because of the way people handle money. Human beings will become so self-serving with regards to money. They will so love money that the final days of human history will become extremely perilous times. And so, this is a prophecy. We're living maybe in the time when we're beginning to see how perilous times can become with regards to financial mismanagement. So, you could say it like this. Paul is essentially saying in his first letter to Timothy, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Now pause, think this through with me. This is the universal statement Paul is making through all of human history. Have we just started to have financial problems at the end of human history? Have people just suddenly become greedy and they never were before? Are we up against something that's an anomaly in human history? No. General universal statement. The love of money is problematic. It is the root of all evil. All through history, wherever you find people who prioritize money over people, you're going to have problems. Universal statement. But then, in his second letter, he says, but in the last days, it's going to go vertical. It's going to go absolutely through the roof. You're going to see financial mismanagement on a scale that you have never seen in human history. In the last days, perilous, dangerous times are going to come because of the love of money. So you could summarize like this. What Paul is saying is what has been will be only on a larger scale. The financial situation in human history has always been bad, but it's going to become like super duper bad. Not in the Greek of that are the words super duper. And I'm translating them for you. Super duper bad. At the end of time, what has been will be. So check this out. But then go back to 1 Timothy, because this is just fabulous to me. So then he tells that we should teach one another something. I'm going to teach you something. You can teach this to me as well. Just pull me aside and remind me of this sometime. I would really appreciate it. So he says, Paul says, okay, Timothy. In the light of the fact that money is the root of all kinds of evil, and in the light of the fact that the last days of human history will be characterized by serious financial mismanagement that will lead to a complete implosion of the system that will be perilous and dangerous. Okay, in light of all that, teach those who are rich in this world, not to be proud and not to trust. So unreliable. I mean, $20 is worth 20 avocados now. $20 is only worth 10 avocados. Before you know it, $20, you'll be able to get one avocado. It's unreliable. The numbers printed on that paper, unreliable numbers. So what should you do? Is it okay to have money? Apparently. It's good to have. Should you trust it? What would the answer be? Don't trust it. Go ahead and have it to whatever degree you can have it. Or use John Wesley's financial. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church. John Wesley's rule was earn all you can with regards to money. Earn all the money you can, save all the money you can, give all the money you can. That was just simple. Okay, so. Don't trust money because it's unreliable. Your trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. This is another snapshot of the character of God. Is God pro-enjoyment or con-enjoyment, according to this passage? Pro, God is the author of pleasure. He's the one that invented enjoyment to begin with, according to the biblical story. God is pro-enjoyment. Does God want you to have a good time? Would God rather you get 20 avocados for your $20 bill or only three? God would much rather you get 20 avocados. So when you make 20 avocados worth of guacamole, you can have a bunch of friends over and have a great time. God would much rather you have enjoyment in your financial life. God wants you to do well financially. One scripture says, I desire above all things that you would prosper financially and be in good health. God is a God who favors enjoyment, but God is just saying, hey, you need to have a hierarchy of value. You need to have a value system. Your value system is, it's okay to have money. It's okay to use that money to have some enjoyment with your friends. Don't trust in money because it is, what is that word again? Unreliable. It moves according to inflation, interest rates, and according to the level of corruption that is enabled by politicians. So don't rely on money. Don't trust him. Trust in God. He'll provide what you need. Trust in God. So then, the word trust occurs in the teachings of Jesus, where he says, children, how hard it is for those who trust in riches to enter the kingdom of God. Notice again, Jesus is not launching a diatribe against riches per se. It's okay to have money. Jesus wasn't a socialist. He wasn't a communist. It's okay to have money. It's okay to have money. But don't trust it. Don't put it at the top of your pyramid of value. Don't trust money, because if you trust money, something's going to change in your psychology. You will begin to think that the money you have is more important than the people in your life. And if you begin to think that the money is more important than the people, all kinds of things will happen that will produce negative effects. And then Jesus says one of the hardest things he ever said. You remember this? You probably heard this if you've not read it for yourself. It's a very common Bible verse that is quoted. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Through the eye of a needle. Anybody here know what the eye of a needle is? You've seen a needle, you put a piece of thread through it, right? It's very small. Once you're older than 40, you can't do it anymore. You have to have a child do it for you to get that thing through there, right? It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Does that sound easy? You can't even get a thread through it, hardly. You think a camel's going to get through it? But Jesus is speaking in what's called hyperbole here. Exaggeration for effect. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Oh my. That's scary. Or is it? You know, you can just remove all the scariness. Just have all the money you can make. But don't trust it. Don't trust in money. Trust in God, Paul says. The economic law of God's kingdom is a very simple one. I'm going to leave you with this. The economic principle of God's kingdom is simply this. In the mouth of Jesus, Luke chapter 6 and verse 38, give. I like the way the translators, although there's no punctuation in the Greek, I like the way the translators in the English translation give us a comment. So you're supposed to feel it like this. Give. And it shall be given to you. Good measure, placed down and shaken together, running over, will be put into your bosom. Into your life, into your, you will yourself be enriched if you operate by the principle of giving. Give, and what will happen? Do you remember that law we talked about, that social law at the beginning? Respect begets respect. Right? A smile on a New York City street begets a smile. Right? If you give the people around you, guess what will happen? They will see your generosity on the level that you are able to be generous, given your particular situation. When people see that you're a giver, here's what will happen. They will reciprocate. And you'll find your whole life enriched, not just financially, because that's the least significant enrichment a person can have. The highest subtle enrichment you can have is positive social relationships. People who like you. People you like. That you eat guacamole with. You enjoy one another's company. You laugh together. Now that's rich. That's rich. Jesus says if you operate by the principle of giving, people will reciprocate. They're just going to tend to treat you the way you treat them. Right? Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom, into your life. For with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. What? We translate that for us. People will tend, now there's always outliers, always exceptions to rules, but people will tend to treat you the way you treat them. Smile, somebody will likely smile back. There are some grumpy people in the world who just cannot smile no matter what. But you will not slow your roll for them. You will just keep smiling at the people who will smile back. As a general rule, people will reciprocate your generosity. If you're good to people, core, the thing that we're all trading, whether it's a $5 bill or a $20 bill or a check that we write or any transaction of monetary value, actually is the big secret. Every time you buy something, every time you sell something,